Thanks everyone for joining. Welcome to today's workshop, which is actually our last workshop before Hack&Roll. I hope you're excited about Hack&Roll since it's starting tomorrow. Today's workshop is about machine learning, and it is being conducted by Yichao from Indeed, who's a senior data scientist at Indeed Singapore office, works with the product team regularly to bring perspectives from a data science angle. Before joining Indeed, he had published a whole ton of papers in conferences and journals, and did a PhD degree in computer science from NTU, which is quite respectable. I think PhDs are very hard from what I've heard. But yeah, he has worked as a software engineer as well to deliver a lot of software solutions, and he continues fantasizing about becoming a full stack technologist. So yeah, welcome Yichao. We also have Calvin from Indeed. So that's all I have. So over to you. Let me stop sharing my screen.
Thanks a lot, Chaitanya, for the kind introduction. Hi everyone, my name is Calvin from Indeed. I hope you guys are doing great today. Just give me a short while, let me share my screen. Okay, cool. Can you guys see my screen? All right, awesome. Yep. So, you know, thanks so much everyone for signing up for today's workshop. So, our objective today is to have fun, learn, and have key takeaways from the workshop. So don't worry, we won't bite at any point in time. Let's say if you have guys during the workshop, if you guys have any question, feel free to unmute yourself and chat with each other, all right? So I think before we start, I wanted to share with you guys a short video about Indeed, you know, how life is like at Indeed. So just be mindful a little bit. The music may be a little bit loud. Okay, so just enjoy a quick 1 minute video. Okay, so welcome again to Indeed's machine learning workshop. We're very excited to be here. And I believe through the video, you guys have seen a lot about this statement, we help people get jobs. And you might also say it from my Yichao and my virtual background. We have this huge statement, you know, we help people get jobs. I'll explain a little bit more. It's actually our company mission. All right. So let me share a little bit first about the agenda, what's going to happen in this two hours workshop. So first, I'll spend about 10 minutes with you guys to do a quick introduction to Indeed. After that, I will share a little bit more about the opportunities that we have for you guys that you guys can apply to, especially if you are looking for a full-time role after graduation or an internship this summer, and also share a little bit more about application process. Next, I'll pass over the floor over to Yichao, who will be conducting the machine learning workshop. And then at the end of the workshop, we will come back together and then we will have a short Q&A session. So again, you can see this big statement here. Just a quick introduction about myself. My name is Calvin and I'm a university recruiter here at Indeed. I joined Indeed about 3 months ago. I've been in the campus recruiting space for 7 years and have hired fresh graduates and interns from diverse backgrounds across multiple industries, such as tech and professional services industry. So before at Indeed, I was at TikTok. So just 3 months into Indeed, I've met so many amazing people and inspiring leaders who are very hands-on and experienced. And I look forward to an amazing adventure with such a great company. So you can see here, Indeed is the number one job search engine worldwide, and we have all the jobs. Sorry, just give me a while. Sorry, I went a little bit far. Yeah, so you can see here, we help people get jobs. I believe you have here quite a number of times already since the start of the event. This slide is really very important, and it comes up at nearly every single leadership presentation at Indeed. Our mission at Indeed is that we help people get jobs. What does this mission mean for our employees? Every employee in some way is supporting this mission. No matter what function you are in, engineering, HR, client success, all have a common goal of helping people get jobs. And it's important for our employees to understand how their role impacts each job seekers. One of the values we have here at Indeed is job seeker first. Whatever we do, whatever projects that we put together, we always have job seeker first in mind. And it's not about employees or profit. Finding a job can be a huge milestone for a lot of people. And, you know, every Indeedians at Indeed, we are just very happy that we are actually part of something that is amazing and good cause. So Indeed, let me share a little bit more about Indeed. Indeed is the number one job search engine worldwide, and we have all the jobs on Indeed.com. What does that mean? Let's think about that. You know, what are some of the places that you can find jobs from? You know, probably in your mind, you can think about company websites, job boards, recruiters, temp agencies, help wanted sign, even newspaper or other other job sites such as monster.com. It sounds really simple, but Indeed.com is really one site with all the jobs from all those sources. And how do we do that? So the word is aggregation. We aggregate them from three major sources. They are pulled from employer career site, or they can be posted directly onto our website. We also help other job boards posting to Indeed, as well as staffing agencies for their client. So you guys must be wondering, you know, why would our competitors, you know, allow for us to pull jobs from their website? This is mainly because our website drives more traffic to their site, and they know that Indeed has more traffic than any other job site in the world. Okay, so when we talk about traffic, we are looking at a big number. So again, we are the number one job site. We have presence in over 60 countries, and we are available in 28 languages. In a month, we have 250 million unique visitors. So if a visitor that actually visit Indeed.com more than once a day is still considered as a unique visitor, and we have over 20 million jobs on our website. So these are all the Indeed offices that we have around the world. Indeed is a multinational company, and we currently have over 11,000 employees worldwide. Okay. So next, I'll move on a little bit more about, you know, definitely one of our purpose here other than to conduct the workshop is to let you guys know that we are recruiting. So by joining Indeed, you know, these are the things that you can look forward to. We are expanding our global footprint and have offices around the world. You will get global exposure and a chance to work with people from different countries and backgrounds. The products and the features you build will impact millions of people in the world. Next, mentoring and networking. And I believe this is a very important thing that all graduates or students should actually look forward to. All new joiners at Indeed will be assigned a buddy and a manager to ensure you have the necessary support to help you succeed. At Indeed, you will get mentorship and the capability to work with seniors who were from top tech companies. Next, we have a very strong work-life balance culture over here. Our employees are foremost the most important to us. And we know in the past year, due to the work from home arrangement, many people have suffered a burnout. At Indeed, we foster a strong work-life balance culture here at Indeed to ensure that doesn't happen. And over at Indeed, you get structure, you get mentorship, you get growth and empowerment. You get to participate in boot camps that is designed by our engineering team to help you get started in your first 12 weeks. Some of the benefits that I would like to touch on is that we have an open leave policy system here at Indeed. And this is for worldwide, in all Indeedians around the world. Even if you exceeded the number of annual leaves you can take, you may still request for PTO as long as your manager approves it. I think this shows how much we have put trust in our employees. Every month, we also get a company-wide off day, which we call here the U Day. Y-O-U, U-Day, for Indians to rest and recharge. I personally like to use the U-Day to spend time with family, friends, and all. Yeah. Okay. So you must be wondering what kind of roles are we recruiting right now. So we have full-time positions right now, and also we are recruiting for interns for this summer. So we are looking for software developers, engineers. We have full-time and internship positions. Data scientists, we have full-time and internship positions, and also for product scientists, full-time internship. So all you need to do is just to visit university.indeed.jobs, and then you can actually view all the available opportunities that we have. So applications are reviewed on a rolling basis. So if you are interested, I would highly recommend you to apply to us as early as possible. So I'll take a few more minutes or so to share about the application process. The application process here in is very straightforward. And transparent. So what you need to first do is to submit your application via our career portal, so which is the link that I shared with you earlier. Next, you will be invited to take part in an online assessment. The type of assessment will vary depending on the role that you have applied for. If you have done well in the assessment, you will be invited to attend our on-site interviews, which we call here a batch day. It's in a form like an interview loop where there'll be 3 to 4 interviews that you go through within a timing. And these are conducted by our Indeed engineers. So if you are successful through the, or if you have passed all the interviews, our HR team will reach out to you and share on the next step. And the recruitment process here is actually the same for both full-time and also internship positions. Okay, so before I leave you with Yichao, I'm going to share with you a short, quick video about our tech office in Singapore. Do enjoy.
So what brought me to Indeed was an opportunity to build a world-class software engineering center in Singapore.
I was very excited about being part of this environment where I have a big amount of contribution to growing the site.
Aside from the fact that we're trying to transform the hiring industry, we're trying to also transform someone else's life.
We are introducing transparency to the world market, closing the gaps between the job seekers and the employers.
The one thing I really liked about Indeed in terms of culture, it's very open, it's very transparent, the leaders are very close to you. You can even walk up to the leaders and ask them a question.
When I joined, I spent 1 month in onboarding and I was like, wow, this is different. Over here, they make very concentrated efforts to make sure you're part of the team.
People really work to be egoless. They want to make the right decisions. They want those decisions rooted in data and informed by data.
We have pretty good collaboration between product engineering and UX. We all sit together, we are all kind of working closely together in little squads. We are working to really grow the team fast.
The idea of the Gong project is to introduce new hires to Indeed's engineering framework within the first week to give them an experience of how is it like to push code out to production so that they feel that they can make an impact.
We're building product that's going to have global reach, global impact. It's deep tech, it's deep product. We're doing stuff that is fundamental to the Indeed product portfolio.
It does require a certain bit of being able to switch roles if needed or being able to put on multiple hats.
We're also looking at people who have a sense about how to solve problems, to come up with solutions, not to abstract computer science problems, but to fundamental product problems.
You should come to work with Indeed if you like to innovate, if you have great ideas, if you like to learn, if you like to try something new, where you know you have great people who will share your idea and help take that forward with you.
Okay. So without further ado, I'll pass over the floor over to Yichao. But before I do, I would like to do just quickly introduce him like what Chai has introduced him earlier. So Yichao is our staff data scientist here at Indeed. So, you know, he has been fully embedded with the product team to continue deliver data science solution. And he helps people get jobs by making sure all the jobs related data are organized in a meaningful manner. So he is also a PhD holder. You know, he has published a huge number of papers and journals. He has also worked as a software engineer for many years, focusing on developing and delivering high quality software solutions. Okay, yeah. So with that, I'll pass the floor over to Yichao. Over to you, Yichao.
Yep. Thank you so much, Kevin. Thank you so much for the exciting presentation. And I'm happy to like take over here. And yeah, hi everyone. My name is Yichao and I'm a data scientist with Indeed. So I will make use of the next maybe 1 hour, slightly more than 1 hour time to work through with you guys to a real Indeed problem. So first of all, probably let me try to share my screen. Yeah. So I just want to reiterate. So whenever I'm going through the slides or the workshop, please feel free to interrupt me anytime if you have any question, or maybe you can also post your questions in the Zoom chat so that I can see your questions and I will try to answer your questions on the way. And also we will leave maybe 15 minutes time for the Q&A session. So you can leave your questions until then as well. And also you are free to ask some other questions related to probably hiring and some other general questions about working at Indeed. So any questions will be welcome at that time. And yeah, feel free to ask questions on the way as well. All right. So yeah, without any further things, I'm going to introduce you the real problems that we are going to work through today. Altogether, right. So the title here is I help people to duplicate jobs. So Indeed, as you already know that the work culture at Indeed is really fun. So as a software engineer and data scientist, we play games every day. One of the favorite games that I would like to play every day is Spot the Difference. I play it with my daughter actually every day as well. So we play this game in our daily work as well. So there are two jobs actually posted at indeed.com. And those two jobs are actually both from PNG. And the title of the job is Site Integrated Planner. And our task here is to find out what are the difference between those two jobs. All right. So kind of an interesting game, right? But I think this will be a good example for you to understand what is the job duplication problem. So first of all, let's try to find out the difference between those two jobs, all right? So first of all, the job on the right side, on the left side, the company name is called PNG without any other things. And the job on the right side is PNG International Operations Singapore Branch. So I think it's the full name of the PNG in Singapore. And technically they are from the same company actually, PNG Singapore, right? But they are different in terms of the text, right? And also if you go through the job descriptions further, you will find the job on the left side don't have the salary information actually, and it shows the location is in Singapore only. But the job on the right side shows the location is in Raffles and it actually shows us the salary range. And also you will find a few more differences from the full job descriptions. For example, the job on the left start with description only, but the job on the right start with rules and responsibilities. Although the content following contents are exactly the same, right? So yeah, it's kind of interesting. And your team here, this is not broad, this is broad. And also what success looks like is the format is different. Yeah, although the most of the contents are the same. And we can 99% sure that those two jobs are actually the same job, but they are listed as two different jobs in Indeed. So this is a problem that we probably want to look at this time. So yeah, feel free to ask if you have any questions regarding this small example. This is very important for you to understand, first of all, so that we can go ahead to complete our task today. Yeah, any like comments or questions so far? Okay, if not, I'm going to like move forward to the next slide. So I think a natural question here is, why do we have job duplicates at Indeed? I believe if you hear carefully about Kevin's introduction about Indeed, Indeed is actually a place to aggregate all jobs from different places. And it is quite natural for a recruiter to send a job post in multiple places, include but not limited to their own corporate site. They will also post a job in various job boards and some other places. And also at the same time, there are a few third-party headhunters. They will repost the jobs after like polishing the job descriptions a little bit by changing the descriptions a little. And also, as I mentioned, Indeed aggregates the jobs from all possible job sources. So we will get all the jobs all together. And we didn't really done a very good job to deduplicate the job if we are not going to do this job deduplication, right? So this is the reason that we have this problem. And I think for any problems that we want a data scientist to work on, the problem should be important. And the question here is, does this job duplicate matter in our business? So I think the answer here is yes, it is very important. And it is important because of two different reasons. So first of all, Indeed is a place to put the job seeker experience at first and all the time. So from the job seeker side, if you are a job seeker and you are actively looking for a job, you will get confused about going through a duplicate job. So let's say I browse software engineer jobs and I try to apply probably for a job, PNG, let's say within the example, but I apply for the first job and like in the second page, I find, okay, there is another software engineer job and with PNG, it seems that I applied it before, but should I apply again or like, is it confusing? Is it probably another job with PNG or whatever? So the job seeker will feel confusing. And also, if the job seeker apply for multiple such jobs, it will also cause some troubles for the employers when they are trying to process the hiring, the interview process or hiring schedules, right? So this kind of affecting the job seeker experience as well as the employer experience. So it's kind of a big deal for the job seekers. And also even within Indeed, we have a few downstream products that rely on the job data. So for example, we have some aggregations to analyze the job and job seeker, the demand from the job seekers and also the demand from the employers for the jobs. So we will have some studies to learn if there are more job seekers than the open jobs or if there are more open jobs than the job seekers. But if there are a lot of job duplicates, this will lead to a very incorrect job numbers per title, per company, per industry, per city, per country. This will eventually lead to a very misleading result if we do some following analysis. And also actually inside Indeed, we have a lot of different information about jobs, including salary and like company aggregation or salary aggregation. So if we come up with incorrect job information, this will give some very negative impact to all the downstream products and analysis as well. So this is kind of a very big issue. And like this actually happened quite often inside Indeed. And when people ask, okay, this is, what is the root cause of this? And people will say, okay, this is all his fault. So we don't want to, I mean, as a salary team, we don't want to do this fault for our colleagues within Indeed. So I think this is again an important problem even within Indeed. So this problem is so important, then let's see what we can do as a data scientist and software engineer at Indeed. All right. So the objective for this task is we try to remove the duplicate job with near duplicate job descriptions. All right. So in the example previously, we want to detect this kind of pairs and remove one of them. All right. Then the challenging here is, well, as you know, Indeed receives hundreds of millions job posts every day. So we have really a lot of jobs globally. So naturally your solution must be fast enough to process the jobs. At least your solution should not be slower than one day to process one day's data. Otherwise it should not be able to, I mean, do anything in the practice, right? And also, I mean, well, when it comes to the data science or machine learning stuff, everybody just think about, okay, we need to use a deep learning. We need to like have thousands or even 10,000 or hundreds of thousands GPUs to complete this task, but is it really needed? And also actually within Indeed, we have a lot of different applications and not every application can occupy so many computation resources. So a basic requirement here is if this task can be fulfilled by some simple ways, simple approach that requires very less resources, just do it. Yeah. So the second requirement here is the solution cannot consume too many resources here. All right. And there is a note here. So mistakes are allowed, but must be controlled in a certain range, which means you can identify some jobs which are not actually a duplicate, and you can actually missing some job, actual duplicate job, but you must make sure such kind of things are within like 1% or 2% or actually in practice, as long as it's less than 10%, it should be actually fine for both precession and recall. We will actually go into the detail to some level when we are going through the code. All right. So before I actually show you the code, I'm going to actually show you some similar applications in the real world. So this task is not actually unique in Indeed. Some other companies or industries may have a very similar problem as well. So for example, for news media, like commodity duplications, for example, you are working for Shopee or like Media Corp or SPH, I don't know. So there might be some like media duplicates, news contents, duplicates, commodity descriptions. So your job is also similar to detect them and do some certain operations towards them. And also based on my own experience, I used to work with a bioinformatic company, which is focusing on the genome-wide association study. So actually the genome sequence is another big data, is another type of big data. And in that case, we want to find similar patterns from your gene sequence. And in that case, this is actually very similar to this application as well. Yeah. And also I believe you might probably have some other interesting ideas that you can associate with your exact problem with this lesson. So if you can do that, I think that's the purpose of this workshop is achieved. Yeah. So anyway, let's just go through, go inside into the code. And before that, I'm going to show you two sources so that you can try to download them and put them into the Google Code app. So whenever I'm throwing, at the same time when I'm going through the code, you are free to try the code on your side as well, all right? So yeah, feel free to let me know if you cannot download them. Otherwise, I'm going to show the instructions on my side. So the code can be loaded via the Google Code app. And you will need to put the source code as well as the data set under the same Google Drive folder so that you can load the data from your Google Code Lab at the same time. Okay, so I will leave like 5 minutes for you to download the data and load the notebook inside your Google Code Lab. and feel free to ask questions. By the way, yeah, the data set is really a real data from Indeed Singapore. That is one day Singapore data. I will give you more details when I'm going through the code. And these two links will be only available during the session. After the session, I will close the link. So yeah, please take this chance to download the data. So yeah, so the next 5 minutes is yours and I will be back in 2:40. Okay, so yeah, I hope you successfully download the resources and you should be able to load this notebook in your Colab. But don't worry if you haven't done so, this video will be recorded and you can maybe view it later if you want. So yeah, do bear with me at this time and I'm going to go through the notebook together with you. And the purpose here is to resolve the job duplication problems. All right. So the solution here contains multiple parts. So starting from access the data all the way to multiple approaches that we are trying to resolve this problem. And I will also give you some takeaway messages at the end. And the whole session will last for about 1 hour. All right. So yeah, as we are all software engineers, as you know, the index must be start from zero. So it's zero-based index. And step zero here is to access the data from your Google Drive. So assuming that you already have the data set downloaded here and you have your source code, what you are going to do is to double click this notebook and you will get this page. And of course, this is very similar to Jupyter Notebook if you are familiar with Jupyter and also Python. So what I'm going to do is to just run the code. I'll provide you the full code source code, so you can just directly run it. And if your data set is placed at the right place, you should expect to run it without any errors, all right? So if it's the first time for you to run the code, you will have to give your notebook the permission to access your Google Drive. Right. Feel free to drop questions here in the chat box. Yeah. So yeah, let's wait for a few more seconds to get this data loaded. So you will have to allow the access. Okay, so if you get this message mounted at G Drive, it means your data has been successfully loaded. So I think as a data scientist, whenever you get the data set, the first task you want to do is to understand what are the data exactly, right? So let's take a look at what are inside this data set. So this data is, as I mentioned, is one day's job information all over Singapore. And it is a real in-depth data in Singapore. And this is the actually truncated data set. So in the data set, we only include three important things. One is job ID. It's a real internal in-depth job ID. So later I can show you with the job ID, we can trace back to the exact job and get all the job information internally. And also we have the job title and job descriptions from the data set, all right? And a simple way to check the data, the first few lines of the data set is using this share command, is this command head. And you can see we have job ID, job title, and this is the job description. All right, so it's there are three columns. All right, I hope you are still with me so far. So next thing is we want to basically load the data into some data structure. So normally we're using pandas, but at this time, because we are going to dealing with a very large data size, and also based on our practical experience, pandas is a little bit slow than if we are doing our own dictionary things in Python. So here we are going to load the data into a dictionary. The key of the dictionary is the job ID, and the content contains a two. One is the title and the other one is the description. All right, so let's do it. As you can see, One day Singapore active job contains 107,000 jobs. That's, I'm not sure if it's a big number for you, but I think it's probably bigger than you're expected, right? Yeah, maybe if anyone like to give me some feedback, you can just type anything in the chat, yeah, to see if it's bigger or not big or small, something like that. So the code here is quite simple, I would say. So the jobs will be the place that we load all the original job data. Then we are reading the CSV file. And for each line, we just split the columns into job ID, title, and job description. Then for each of the job record, we just store the data into the jobs dictionary using job ID as the key. And the content will be a dictionary as well. All right, yeah. So feel free to ask questions. I mean, indeed, we ask a lot of stupid questions as a begin. I mean, whenever we are going to get a new task. So I myself ask a lot of stupid questions or silly questions like, why do we have so many jobs? Something like that, yeah. So feel free to ask questions if you have any, all right? So if you don't ask questions, I'm going to just move forward. All right, so after you just load the data into a dictionary, the first step that the data scientist will do always is to explore the data, right? So we now know there are three columns, job ID, job title, and job description. But what are the distribution of them? What are the most common titles? What are the keywords? All those things can be very interesting for you to fulfill your following tasks, right? So anyway, it will probably give you some sense like what are the data look like. All right, so I will basically just choose two EDA works here, but you can probably add more if you want later after the workshop. So the first thing I would like to explore is this one, the distribution of job description length. All right, so here we are importing a seaborn as a library, as a figure prop library. I think it's quite common. So I'm not going to dive deep into this library itself. But here we are going to just try to plot the distribution for the length of job description for all the jobs in the job dictionary. All right. And you can find here is the distribution. I would say this is a perfect normal distribution in log scale, although I plot it in a linear scale. But if you can find it, there is a pretty long tail, and most of the jobs has a distribution. Description size at about maybe 1,000 words. So not so many jobs are with a very long job description, and not many jobs are with a very small job description. Okay, a long tail is actually a very nature, thing for all the all different web-based contents. So I cannot really give you a very precise explanation here, but like for some real cases, the job has a very long description, it can be possible, but the quantity of those jobs will be always small. So it's the same long tail rule applies to the job viewing or with YouTube, or let's say the commodity viewing or purchase behavior from an e-commerce company. Let's see, only a small number. I think it's related to 80-20 rule. So the most popular 20 items always attract 80% of the behaviors, something like that. Yeah, so here the same, the 80% of the job descriptions will in this range, and only like 20%, maybe less than 10% of the jobs will have a very high, a very long job description and small job description as well. So basically it's a normal distribution, I would say. Yeah, so this is one easy work that we can do. And also, I think you might be also interested in the job title itself as well, because we have job description, we have job title as well. So why not just explore a little bit more about job title itself? So here, what I can think about is a word cloud to say what are the most common job titles that we have in Singapore. And surprisingly, yeah, I think as we can see here, software engineer is one of the most popular jobs in Singapore, which means this the job requirement is really hot in Singapore nowadays. A lot of companies are trying to hire software engineers in Singapore. And also, as Kevin mentioned earlier, we really support all kinds of jobs, not only the blue collar or white collars. We cover all different jobs, unlike LinkedIn. So, well, LinkedIn is probably one of our competitors, but LinkedIn only serves the high-end jobs like IT jobs and some other jobs with high pay. But indeed, we also support like customer service representative, specialist, officers, some low-end titles as well, admin assistant, but also we support the high-end jobs like software engineers, business development managers, sales executive, project managers, senior manager, something like that. Yeah. Why does manager appear twice? So I think it's based on the tokenization for the work cloud. So it actually tried to token two words at the same time. So this manager is actually following project. So project manager is a specific title for a job. It's not simply manager, it's product manager. And here is, I think it's a more general manager. And here is assistant manager. So assistant manager is treated as one word here in this word cloud. Yeah, I think that's a good question. Yeah, sorry, I think the question from the student is directly to me, but the question here is why does the manager appear twice? So the answer here is, yeah, the tokenization stuff. All right, yeah, so those are the two example EDA works that we can do normally based on the given data set. And actually in our real life, I will spend at least 1 or 2 days to do more EDA works to a new data set once I get a new data set and as well as a new task. So yeah, so in real life, we will do a lot of more EDA works. Probably we will try to understand, is there any abnormal stuff? Let's see, we will try to spot check some jobs at this end with very long job descriptions. What happens to that specific job? And some jobs, for example, they have only 10 words in the job description. We also want to understand what happens for this very short job description as well. Yeah, so those spot check can be also a very important part of the EDA work in real life. So the question here is, are those specific technologies to spot check if something's wrong? So normally we will check two ends, right? So the small end and the big end. And I think there's no specific technologies here, as far as I know, at least. So what I'm going to do is I will, actually I can show you something later, but internally at Indeed, we can find all the job details for one specific job ID. So based on this prod, I will be able to find some jobs with very short job description with a job ID. So with that job ID, I can further extract the full information of the job itself. Then I will have to use my own eyeballs to go through the job from the job description, the company, the employer name, the salaries, the post data and post date, and a few other things to make sure this job is correct or not. Yeah, sometimes I will have to ask some other teams about the job metadata as well. So we have job metadata team, and we have salary team, we have a lot of different teams related to jobs. Yeah, because job is definitely one of the most important content at Indeed. So for spot check, it's normally based on the experience and human eyeballs. But EDA works will definitely help you to figure out what are the specific jobs you will have to look by using your human eyeballs. All right. Okay, I assume we are all clear so far for the EDA work. So I think the next step is kind of an easy task as the beginning. So whenever a data scientist get a task, right? So the working process is like that. Every team has a product manager, and the product manager is kind of in charge of define the product directions, define the task, and try to figure out if a new task is worthy for some more intensive investment by getting more data scientists and product managers and software engineers and even QAs to work on that. So the first step is normally data scientists will work together with product managers closely to figure out if the specific task is worthy to invest with more time and more resources. All right. So the first task first is always, can we start with some simple things that don't need any complex machine learning steps or whatever things, so that we can finish it within maybe, let's say, 1 week or maybe even a few days. So that in that case, we can quickly complete this task and generate some product impact. That would be the best case, actually. So anyway, the first task here is when we are talking about the job duplications, right? The first task, if you're from the CS background, we'll think about is how about let's using hash set. Then we store everything job description into the hash set. Then we can simply identify the identical job descriptions by using very small resources. And this time complexity would be very low here. So I think the code here is exactly doing this. So we construct a map to store the description and job description and job ID. So we're using a for loop, and we check if each item present in the dictionary already. So this is a very basic software engineer skills for everyone to detect the identical items by using Python or whatever. So I think here is a good attempt at the first place. So the code here is we are going to, as we mentioned here, we are going to declare a new dictionary called unique jobs. And we have a job description set. So we are going to go through all the jobs inside the original jobs data. And if the job descriptions is already inside this set, we will determine this is a completely identical job description. Otherwise, we just add this job description as a new job description to the set. And next time we see the same job, this will be detected as exactly the identical job description, okay? So I think this is quite straightforward by using this 4 or 5 lines. And this is a very basic and common software engineer skills, not only in Python and everywhere. So if you are preparing for your interview, I think this is the basic things that you need to know at least. So let's try to run this and let's see if we can find out something. So yeah, I think it's quite exciting that we find there are 1,300 plus jobs are exactly the same duplicates from I think overall we have 107,000 jobs. About, I think the ratio is about a little bit less than 1% of the jobs. We are now detecting them as duplicate jobs, right? So I think it's really awesome. Yeah, it's not a bad attempt. At least we are going to find out about 1% of the jobs are completely identical, so we can try to remove them so that at least for the job seekers and also for the internal in the product teams, we are helping them to reduce the mistakes by at least 1% by using this just simple approach in 5 lines. Wow, I think that's really awesome, actually. Yeah, so we are seeing some real product impact from this simple approach. However, I think this is not actually enough in the real life, indeed, because I think the purpose is we try to detect the near duplicates. It of course includes the cases that two job descriptions are totally identical, but we also want to detect if the two jobs have a very similar job description, but not exactly the same description. And let's see if we can do something better here. Right. So I hope so far everyone is still with me. Yeah, feel free to ask questions anyway, again. Awesome, yeah. I would like to have this sum up emojis all the time. So yeah, then I think after we try the most basic things, well, we know we can do something with the basic things, but it's not enough, right? So this is a machine learning workshop and we are dealing with the text features. So the next nature step is how about let's just explore some NLP techniques, right? So the first approach I'm going to introduce here is to check the pairwise text similarity. So when we come to the text similarity, so I think we have some question here. So the word time, I think we don't really have to worry about the word time, but what I'm going to ask you to focus is the CPU times. The word time is probably the overall time that are calculated within this cell. Yeah, but the CPU times will be a good indicator for you to indicate the complexity of your algorithm. So we haven't touched this so far, but that's a good question from you guys so that actually later I will ask you to focus on this for some reason, all right? I think we already have a good answer here. What time refers to the actual time that will pass if you start a physical clock? That's right. Awesome, thank you. And I think that's a better job than I have did. Thanks. So is it true that the same job descriptions will always be from the same job ID? I think that is not true, simply not true, because in that case, we wouldn't have any job duplication problem, right? But here, the problem here is for those 1,300 plus jobs, the job description of them are exactly the same as one of the other jobs, and the job ID are different from the previous job that with the same job account, the job description. All right, awesome. Yeah, thanks. So let's continue. So we were here, right? So the pairwise text similarity. And when we come to the text similarity, one of the basic concept here is so-called Jacquard index. So I think you must want to ask what is Jacquard index? And I paste a wiki link here. So in short, Jacquard index is a very simple value calculated based on the interaction over union, all right? So it's an interaction over union. And I will give you a very simple example here as well. So if we are going to check the Jacquard distance between two simple strings, how are you and how old are you? The Jacquard score will be 3/4. So where is 3, where is the 4? 3 means there are 3 words are exactly the same. So how are you? How are you are 3 words, right? How old are you also contains those 3 words, how, I, and you, but the word old is different from those two strings. So the intersection of those two strings contains 3 words, how, are, and you, and the union of string 1 and string 2 contains 4 words, how, old, and are you. Okay, so in that case, the Jacquard distance between those two strings will be 0.75, which is 3/4. All right. I hope I'm not too fast here. But yeah, please let me know if you have any question about Jacquard distance. Yeah, if not, I'm going to just go forward. All right. So I think once we have this capability to check the text similarity, the very natural next step for us to do is for each pair of the jobs, we just want to check the similarities from the job descriptions, pair by pair, right? So in that case, we just iterate each job pair using 2 for loops. And unfortunately, it will be an O n squared time complexity. So I will touch this later when we are going to check the CPU time and work time, all right? And the logic here is we are going to calculate the pairwise jacket goal and check the highest one. And we will have a threshold, a practical threshold to fill out if the jacket distance is very high for the two jobs, then it is very likely that those two jobs are near duplicate, all right? So let's go through the code a little bit as well. So here I'm selecting 8 different jobs here. The reason here is actually if we want to run the algorithm for the whole data set, I probably suspect we will need additional 20 hours for this workshop, which is impossible. So yeah, I basically just select 8 jobs here and I will show you the time consumed here with this algorithm as well as the following algorithms, all right? And also we have a dictionary to store the potential duplicates so that we can print out what are the duplicates that we found out, all right? So again, we are going to iterate all the jobs in the first for loop, and we are going to get the maximum description similarity for each job if we compare this job with all the rest jobs. And we also store the match if we find there is a potential duplicate job. And also we have the description as we get the job description from this job ID as well. And inside this for loop, we are going to compare this job with all the rest job. So we're not, first of all, we're not going to compare the job with itself, right? So the job, it must be duplicate with itself, and that's not the purpose of our task. The purpose is for us to compare this job with a different job with different job ID. And here is, we are going to calculate the jacket similarity. Oh, sorry, I forgot to give you some simple code walkthrough for the jacket function. So here is the jacket function. So we have two sets and we are going to calculate the intersection as well as the union. So the value returned by jacket function will be the interaction over union. Okay, this is based on the definition of jacket distance. So here we are going to just calculate the job description similarity by calculating a jacket distance between two job descriptions. All right. And here, if the job description, if the job description similarity is maximal, then the, because for every job, we just want to find another job that is most similar to the job, right? So we will try to find that specific job. And eventually, once we find the most similar job, if the most similar job to this job is larger than a certain threshold, we will consider this is a potentially duplicate jobs. All right. So let's try to run it and let's see how long will it take. Actually, I've give you the exact number here already. So for these 8 jobs only, we will have to take about 40 seconds for the 8 jobs only. All right. So it's an n square time complexity, which means if we are going to increase these 8 jobs into 8,000 or or even a large number, we have 100,000 plus jobs, right? It's not a linear increase. It's a square scale increasing. So if we are going to calculate for 100,000 plus, I think actually one day is not enough. Yeah. So yeah. Anyway, is there a way to optimize this? A long database might take really long, right? That's right. That's exactly what I'm going to introduce you in the following approaches, right? Exactly. I think you all give very good suggestions. Given the huge time complexity, is jacket index still used those days to get duplicates? I think you will get the answer for this question exactly after the workshop finish at the end. Okay, so I'm not going to give you the direct answer at this time, but please be with me all the way until I finish this workshop, all right? Anyway, yeah, I think we all see the CPU time here is about 50 seconds. And from these 8 jobs, we find those two jobs are very similar with each other. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, I think it's quite exciting for us to do some spot check, and I'm going to show you how exactly I'm doing this at Indeed. So this is an internal Indeed page that we can do to check the job information. So this is a so-called doc service. This is document service. And here we can find the apply UI, the format, the city, company ID, country, the dates that created, the job descriptions, and all different things here. Yeah, a lot of things really. But here we will mainly focus on the job description, all right? So let's see those two jobs. So first of all, let's first confirm the job ID for those two jobs are different, right? So as we find, one job ID ends with 11, the other one ends with 25. So this is 25, this is 11. They are two different jobs with different job ID. But if we look at the job description, so I think it might be easier for me to move it out. Well, let's see. As we can see, at the first glance, I think they are very, very, very similar with each other. First of all, they are from the same company, Sign-T. It's Sign-T. Even with the same company ID, and they are all in SG, but this position is different. I don't exactly know what is this position, but if we look at the job description, you will see here, the company is trying to find an independent finance charge analyst. Here, we are trying to find an independent UAT analyst, but if you are not familiar with UAT, the UAT is basically a short abbreviation for this financial change things. So they are actually the same job. And if you look at the rest of the job description, they are exactly the same. So let's do this comparison. This is the way I do the human eye spot. So yeah, so I just look at here. So I find there's nothing has been changed here. So yeah, I would 99% confident that those two jobs are duplicate. And yeah, we using our algorithm to find out these duplicates. That's really awesome, right? However, there's still a problem here, right? So as we mentioned, it takes 50 seconds to figure out the job duplicates just within 8 jobs. But if we scale this up into 100,000 plus jobs, that will take forever, right? So next is something that we need to optimize for the computational complexity. All right, so it seems the pairwise comparison is anyway too time consuming, and we cannot really do it for given the job data that we have at Indeed. So next thing is we are going to do something different to optimize this. All right, I hope everyone is still with me. Yeah, so feel free to ask me questions anyway. Okay, so yeah, I think when we are talking about NLP, jacquard distance is one thing, but we have a few other approaches as well, right? And n-gram is one of the things as well. So let me try to introduce you n-gram a little bit as well. So here, n-gram means a continuous sequence of n words, and a document can be actually represented by all the n-grams it contains. What does it mean? So I'm going to show you an example here as well. So the example here is, let's say a sentence. The sentence itself is called, this is a sentence, all right? So this sentence contains 4 words. And we can actually construct some n-grams to represent the job as well. So let's say if we are going to select n equals to 1, which means that's a unigram. So this sentence can be represented as, this is a sentence. So this is actually an array of string to represent this specific sentence, all right? And if we choose two, n equals to two here to represent the sentence, the array, the string array will become this is and is a and a sentence. All right. So it's a moving window. It's kind of similar to the sliding window here. And if we choose n equals to three, then this sentence can be represented as two elements in a string array, which is this is an and is an sentence. Okay. So is it clear so far? I hope this example is still clear to you and serve you with, thanks for that. I really like the thumb up again. Okay, so yeah, assuming that you all know the n-gram things here, then let's try to construct a map of job ID, and the key is job ID and the value is the set of n-grams to represent the document, the jobs here, all right? Yeah. So here I'm going to go through the code a little bit as well. So let's see, we choose n gram length as 7. The 7 here is actually a practical number that derived from the empirical result. And here we are going to construct this kind of dictionary as I just mentioned here. So first of all, we are going to declare this dictionary and we will return it at the end of the function. And for each jobs, we will extract the job ID and job data. So keep in mind that job data contains job description and job title. Then the word token is actually the job descriptions. And here we are going to extract all the single words from the job data. And here we are going to just extract the n-grams from the word tokens. So we just concat the words, the continuously 7 words into one string and put this string into the array. So this will be the thing that we have. And this operation will take about 15 seconds to construct this dictionary. And this is kind of actually a model. And this is kind of a one-time thing because you will have to construct the dictionary for one time and you can use it for all the jobs later, right? So yeah, as we can see, it's about 14 seconds to complete the dictionary construction. And I think in case you are still not very clear about what are inside this so-called n-gram as a feature to represent the word, I'm going to give you an example with three jobs only. So there are three jobs, let's see. Job one and job two are very similar with each other actually. So the only difference here is job one declares it requires 4, 5 to 10 years experience using this English word two. And in job two description, it just replaced this two by a hyphen. And the meaning of those two jobs are still very similar, right? And job three will be completely a different job. So let's see what will be inside this dictionary that we want to construct. So first of all, there's a dictionary and the key is the job ID, all right? 1, 2, and 3. And as we mentioned in the example, we are going to use n-grams as a feature to represent the job. So it contains all the n-grams. In this case, it's a 2-gram. Then in the first job, it will be 10 years. 5 to blah, 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 always till the end of the job description. I think the end is like Jenkins. So we will do the same thing for job two and job three, okay? So hope this example is helpful for you to understand this. That's right. Yeah. If you consider this 4 as an N, if it's ON, but if you consider this, if you consider this as an N, it would be still N squared, I would say. Yeah, but this is a one-time thing. I think you can do the time complexity analysis later because you all have the source code and you can actually change the code a little bit to play around with it. Yeah, but anyway, I think the CPU time will be a very good indicator to the time complexity analysis. All right. So I hope, yeah, this example helps you to understand what are inside this dictionary. And what we are going to do next is we are going to randomly sample a few n grams for each job. Then we're just going to compare the n grams samples with the full n grams dictionary. So if all the samples that we get from all the n grams samples we get from a different job are existed in this job, so we can fairly see those jobs might be similar with each other. So the thing here is we will have to choose a proper number of samples as well as a proper number of n for n grams. So there is obviously a trade-off between the time complexity and the precision recall performance. We will touch that later, but here I think what you are going to keep in mind is it does not guarantee 100% accurate, but it gives 90% accurate in this example. So because there are in total 20 different 2 grams, bigrams for job A, job one and job two, and only 2 of them are different. So if you unluckily, you sample one of the n grams, let's say if you sample this iPhone 10, and this iPhone 10 is never existed in job one, and in that case, you will miss this, right? So that is a trade-off and you will have to select that. And actually it is possible for you to mathematically prove the precession and recall accuracy using some mathematical tricks. This will not be the focus of this workshop. The thing here is as long as you can prove, you can achieve 90% plus performance in terms of accuracy or like precession recall F1 score, that would be good enough for you to argue with product managers or even further to deliver the actual product impact later. All right. So yeah, here, let me try to go through the code briefly as well. So we are trying to find out, we're trying to sample the n grams from each job. So here we have a random locations. Then for each random locations, we try to take the n gram strings, then we try to compare if the n gram strings are already existed in other jobs. Then if the potential jobs is none, then we think this job contains random grams, right? Then if it's not none, which means we successfully find out some potentially duplicate jobs so that we simply put that job into the final result. And eventually we are going to figure out if we find anything there. Okay, so let me just try to directly run this. So we find, okay, in this example, 1 and 2 are very likely that they are duplicates, which is exactly meeting with our expectation. All right, yeah. Then let's try to extend this into the 8 jobs example. So here we only apply this to the simple example, artificial example here. And next, let's try to apply this to the 8 jobs example, while the 8 jobs are from the real indeed jobs, okay? While the code are still very similar with each other, so we just copy and paste this part to here, and we have a outer for loop to iterate the jobs from all the target jobs. Okay. So let's try to run this. Yeah, it takes 1.9 seconds to find out the job duplicates. And surprisingly, it finds out this one, the 25 and 11, those jobs are similar with each other. However, it also finds some additional jobs that might be similar to the original job as well. Yeah, that's awesome, right? And more importantly, previously it took us 50 seconds to do the same thing. And with this n-gram, as well as the dictionary, we are able to reduce the computational time, the CPU time, from 50 seconds to about 2 seconds. That's a 25 times improvement in terms of the running time, right? So I hope you are still with me so far. Yeah, so if there's no questions, I'm going to give you a quick summary all the way until here. So here we've actually select random n-grams as a feature to represent the job. And we are actually built a classification model with the rules only if all the selected n-grams are exactly represented in another job, then this will be a similar job. We will mark it as one, otherwise it will be zero. So it's a classification task, but we are doing it with a very different way. I mean, not very traditional machine learning ways, but we are doing it with our software engineer skills, but we are doing a classification task here. And actually we are using the n-grams as the feature set in this task. And in the real world, there are some other features that we can think about actually to do the same task. For example, the TF-IDF, term frequency and inverse document frequency. And also we can use this data set and together with a more traditional classification model like SVM or other things. I'm not going to dig deeper into here, but I would say those are possible, but within Indeed, the practical way is still using this kind of software engineer skills to solve the question here, because that's good enough for us at this time. All right. So yeah, if you are still with me, then let's see what is inside approach 3B. Because here it's 1.91 seconds for 8 jobs, which is still probably too high for the whole jobs in Indeed, because we are considering Singapore jobs in this task, and Singapore jobs already contains 100 plus thousand a day. But if we apply this to our US jobs, which means we are going to have 25 million jobs a day, right? This 1.9 seconds is still too big to be practical in that case. So in that case, let's see if we can do something better than this 2 seconds. So the answer here is yes, there are still some tricks that we can do further. And the trick here is so-called inverse index. All right. So if anyone not familiar with inverse index, the concept itself is really simple. So previously we are constructing a dictionary using job ID as a key and n-gram as the value. And the concept of inverse indexing is just swapping the key and values in the dictionary. And I think early age, the inverse indexing is also one of the cool technologies for the search engine like Google. They are using this as well to speed up their searching result. Yeah, anyway, here, the thing is quite simple. So we are going to construct a dictionary by swapping the key and values as in our previous example. So let me try to construct the dictionary here. So again, we are going to go through the jobs and we are going to separate the job tokens. And for each jobs, we are going to construct the job tokens into n-gram. But the difference is we are going to swap the key and value here. And in this step, it probably takes about 50 seconds to construct this dictionary. And again, this is the one-time cost. You can consider this as a model that we are going to train and we are going to use it later. So yeah, that's a good question. So do you use any deep learning approaches like transformers for such problems? We think about deep learning, right? But I think the normal practice in Indeed, as well as I believe in most of the companies, we start from the simple approach, then let's see if we can resolve the problem with simple solutions. Then if the simple solution cannot achieve good performance, then we improve it continuously. And deep learning is one of the possible way. However, the most popular embedding steps based on the textual features that I believe deep learning can be used is embeddings. And embedding is more like for us to understand the similar jobs instead of duplicate jobs. So for example, we can use deep learning and embedding steps to understand the software engineer job requirement from Google is similar from the software engineer job requirement from Facebook or even Indeed. However, if we want to use deep learning or word embeddings to find out the duplicate jobs, at least for me, I cannot come up with a proper idea like using deep learning steps to help us to detect the duplicates. It is possible, but I don't think it will be much, much better than the n-grams and jaccard distance tracks that we are using here. Okay, but I would definitely say deep learning is possible and we think about it, but at least based on our experience, this might not be a very suitable solution for this specific task. But anyway, I think that's a very good question anyway. So yeah, let's just go on. We construct the inverse index things. And here is an example for you to understand what is inside the inverse index. So previously, the key is the document index, the job index, right? Job one has this kind of tokens, n-grams. Job two has this kind of n-grams. And here in this inverse index, we just swap the keys and values. So for this specific token, we have job two. This specific token, both job one and job two contains this. Both job one and job two contains this n-gram. So on and so forth. And the beauty thing here is we can actually reduce the time complexity significantly by using this inverse index, because eventually we are trying to get the job index instead of n-gram. So the best thing here is we are going to put that into the value. Yeah, and similarly, we just change one line. So this line was this because we are going to go through all the jobs. So there is actually a for loop. There is actually a for loop inside this line. And we are going to change that for loop into a one single operation so that we reduce the time complexity from n into on into o1 here for this step. And you can feel the difference here if I just run this cell. Yeah, it's basically less than 1 millisecond to find out the possible duplicates. And if we compare the result between this and the previous one, you will find they are exactly the same. It's 11, 44, 43, and 25. This is 11, 44, 43, and 25. So which means basically we are reducing the execution time from 2 seconds to less than 1 millisecond. And at the same time, we are achieving the same target. All right, yeah, that's really awesome, right? And to be honest, it's very exciting to me as well. So yeah, if you are still with me, I'm going to give you a short summary as well. So reverse indexing is actually a form of clustering task as well. So here the key is n-gram and value is document indices. And of course we can perform more complex clustering by changing the key into IFIDF. I mentioned this before, but yeah, I forgot to copy and paste the wiki page here. So if you want to know more about TF-IDF, you can find something here. So the difference here is it actually considers the weighting for each tokens, which we don't have which we didn't consider if we are using the n-gram things, if we compare n-gram with TF-IDF. And as I just mentioned when I tried to answer the question about deep learning, embed vectors might be a possible solution, but the thing is, at least from our perspective, we haven't figured out a feasible way to do it, but probably you can do it, yeah. So I just give you this kind of information here. All right, I hope everyone is still with me until now. And if so, we are going to reach to our final approach, which is the actual solution that we are using to reduce job duplication at Indeed. So we've covered three different approaches so far. And I think there was a question about is Jakarta distance still useful nowadays, given the big time complexity? I think the problem is not with Jakarta itself. Yes, Jakarta is slow because we need to compare all the word tokens, but we also need to do a pairwise comparison. I think the biggest problem is the pairwise comparison to compare each job pairs, and the time complexity will be n squared. And if we already have the indices, right? We already have the reverse index to reduce the search and time complexity a lot. We can probably, again, apply the Jakarta distance to double confirm if the potential duplicate jobs find from the reverse index is correct or not. So I think there is a very common practice when we are doing big data system. There are multiple steps, and normally there are two steps. One is fast and one is slow. So it's called fast and slow. A fast process is normally you make use of some hashing checks like inverse index, dictionary, or whatever things. The purpose of the fast process is to pre-screen and reduce the searching spaces significantly so that we are able to deal with a very large amount of data at the same time. This is not only unique for this job duplication task, this is also very common for the recommendation systems. Like at Indeed, we also have recommendation systems. We recommend jobs to the job seekers. We are trying to find the right job for the right job seeker. However, we have millions of active jobs. And actually for Indeed, we have millions of active job seekers as well. So at Indeed, we also have a fast process to filter the job seekers for each job in a fast process. And secondly, in a slow process, we are going to do the pair comparison to the job for the jobs with all the job seekers that we find in the fast process. So in this specific example, we are using the inverse index as the pre-screen. And the key point here is we are trying to make sure the recall of the first fast process is high while the precision can be slightly low. So for every machine learning system, there is always a trade-off between precision and recall. You can basically tune the threshold to make your recall higher but precision lower, or maybe on the other side, on the other way to get a higher precision but lower recall. But in this fast and slow process, the fast process normally need a high recall but slightly lower precision, and let the slow process to make sure your precision is up to your requirement. Okay, so in this example, since we already introduced Jakarta distance, a possible way for us to check is we use the inverse index to check the job descriptions. And in the second slow approach, we are using Jakarta distance to check the job description. And motivation here is if you spend some time to look at your data, you will find there are some jobs from the same company. So the majority of the job distribution, the majority of the job description will be about the company introduction. So let's say Indeed are trying to hire a software engineer, a data scientist, and product managers. But 90% of the, maybe 80% of the job descriptions will be about the introduction of Indeed, while the rest 20% is about the specific job requirement for different positions. So in order to avoid this kind of situation, we're trying to use the inverse index based on the job description to find the potential duplicate jobs. And then we are going to use the jacket distance to detect if those potential job duplicates are from the same company, but for different positions, all right? So in that case, we can just simply run this. Yeah, and we find some job duplicates. Well, I see there's something wrong here. Oops. I think there's something wrong here. Oops. I think that I made some mistake here, but the thing is we will be able to find about 20,000, about, 10,000 jobs here, yeah. Let me try to rerun everything one more time. Ah, I think I forget this. So yeah, I think let's move back. So for this, we try to extend into 100 plus jobs eventually, because previously we all play around with 8 jobs and we find for 8 jobs, it requires only less than 1 millisecond. So it is possible. I think the performance here is good enough for us to move forward to check if we can really apply this to the whole data set that we have. And here we find, okay, with the very start, with the very initial stage process that we try to find the complete identical jobs will be, we are able to find about 1,000 plus jobs over 100,000 plus, which is less than 1%. However, actually with this fast and slow process, we are able to find out about 16,000 jobs are actually duplicates, which means there are about more than 10% of the jobs are duplicates, which is a really big number, right? And that's why we mentioned at the very beginning, this is very bad for the job seeker experience as well as the downstream in the products. Yeah. And I think that's roughly all about the code. And the most exciting part, especially for myself, I would like to manually confirm if the jobs that we find, if the job pairs that we find are actually duplicates. Okay, so let's try to, so I cannot check here. So we try to randomly select 5 jobs, 5 job pairs from those 16,000 job pairs that we find from our code. And we try to compare if they are really duplicates. All right, so let's do it. I just copy this. Yeah. And I'm going to copy. Copy one more. Yeah. Oh. Okay. Okay, it sounds like we are doing a good job. So first of all, the job itself are all from ST Electronics. Yeah, I think this is a Singapore company. And let's try to see if they are the same. Well, yeah, interesting. So here we have a job description as the beginning. And in this job, it does not have the job description. However, if you continue to read through the job description, you'll find provide system engineering and operation support for SOC's product. Provide system engineering and operation support for, that's exactly the same, right? And job requirement, that's the same. Degree, diploma in computer science, engineer or related disciplines. Yeah, that's exactly the same, I would say. Apart from the beginning, that it's starting from the job descriptions, and this one does not have this job description. Oh, I think we, at least this demo is successful. Yeah, cool. So yeah, we can probably In the real life, I will probably do a few more spot check to make sure that these algorithms really work. And actually in the real life, we will do some more A/B tests and product monitors by involving more human verified samples and metrics monitoring. And also we will have to think about some ways to continuously improve our models. I think I'm already show you some steps to evolve our solution from the very simple hash set to the final fast and slow process using inverse index and Jaccard distance to double confirm. So let me try to recap what I've covered in this workshop. So we are starting from a very simple task using dictionary and set as efficient in-memory data structure to detect the completely identical job duplicates. And always keep in mind that here we are talking about a very specific application that is job duplication. And we've tried to use Jaccard distance to check the pairwise text similarity. However, the complexity will be very high because we will need a lot of iterations, and inside each iteration, Jaccard similarity check is not fast. And we try to use n-grams to represent the job description. This helped us to improve the speed a little bit, but that's not good enough. So we further introduced the inverse index to further speed up the process, which allow us to finish the screen for all the Singapore jobs within 1 second, right? Oh, that's awesome. It's actually 286 milliseconds. It's still less than 1 second for Singapore jobs. And actually in that case, we are comfortable and confident that if we expand this to the US, it will take maybe less than 1 hour to just process 1 day's data for our global data in India. And also we introduced a two-stage process, a fast and slow, to improve the performance eventually. So what will happen in the real life is we will actually move forward this initiative into the production release, and we will do an A/B test to show the job seekers, for example, when in the group, in the control group, the job seekers will still see the duplicate jobs. Then in the control group, we are going to remove all the potential duplicates, and we are going to check if the job seekers' stay time, for example, apply through rate or like dislike rate or non so-called negative feedback can be reduced or not. Then also we have some product monitoring stage to involve a bit more human verified stage. And also we are going to keep eye on the metrics change as well. And of course, we are going to continuously improve the models. And I think I have a few ideas on how to improve the performance. Like there's always a trade-off between precision and recall. So how to get the trade-off mathematically and practically is one thing. And also, if we are going to sample a lot of n-grams as well as n-gram is long, then it might take a lot of memory space as well. So we can further hash n-grams into hash code so that we can further reduce memory size. And also what document and job embeddings might be another big direction as well. Yeah. So yeah, that's roughly the end of the code walkthrough, and I hope you enjoy it. So I believe you also download the source code as well as the data set, so you can play around with the code data on your side. And feel free to ask me questions at the last, because we will have 12 minutes for the Q&A session at the end. Yeah, thanks.
Hi guys, thanks so much. Thanks so much, Yichao, for the time that you have spent, you know, on this organizing this workshop. Thank you very much. And hi all students. I hope you guys have learned something, you know, out of this workshop and have key takeaway. Yeah. So we have a very short time left, you know, about 10 minutes left, you know, for the Q&A session. So over here also, I have Inche, our senior data scientist. She's actually not feeling well today, but, you know, she's very committed. She wanna be here to speak to you guys. So if you guys have any question, feel free to check with us. So any HR related question, you can check with me. It can be anything that's pertaining to, for example, the technology in Indeed, or what you have, for example, what each child do on a daily basis, or what you should do on a daily basis. Yeah. You can either unmute yourself or just drop the question in the chat. Okay, I just wanted to share. So we are recruiting for data scientists. We are recruiting for software engineers, data scientists, and product scientists. So if you are interested in these three functions or these three areas, domains, feel free to look at our career page. You can search for University Indeed, and you'll be able to find our career page, and you can apply to the roles directly. Yep. Any question? Or you guys have all the information. What is the pay like for interns? I think that is quite, unfortunately, we are not able to share the exact number, but you can be rest assured that the our compensation is very competitive in the market. Okay, but I think as interns, you guys should definitely look more than what, for example, things like the pay. I think as intern, you guys definitely, you know, things that you can look at is like projects. The mentorship that you guys will get in the firm, I think that is very important for your growth.
Yeah. Okay, good. I think I can take the next question.
We have a next question from Sherwin.
That's right. So what is the difference between data scientists and product scientists? So that's a good question. Actually, I think not many companies have those two scientist roles specifically, but I think indeed we have, because we have a better production definition here. So the data scientist is kind of more moving forwards towards the software engineer, while the product scientist is more, the skill set of product scientist is more similar to the product managers. For example, a data scientist can be a full stack data scientist with very strong software engineers. So the data scientist can deliver the end-to-end solutions, including building models, do the EDA works, analyze the data, and do the production code change, push to the production, and do the A/B test. However, on the product scientist side, their work is less focused on the software engineer part, let's say the production code implementation, but they will spend much more time to work with the product managers to define the product goals, to monitor the performance of the ongoing A/B test, to change the metrics of, or even define the OKRs, organization key metrics, something like that. Yeah, so I hope that helped you to understand the difference between them. So
just to add on, like, although product scientists work more closely with product manager, they still like belong to the same data science org, like data scientists and product scientists. Yeah,
right.
And they like product scientists, they don't own the product, they just do the analysis and try to push a product forward. Yeah.
Exactly, yeah. They are still similar with each other. Okay, I see the next question is for Calvin.
Yeah.
When is the next time I can apply if I've applied last year? To this student, have you gone through the interview process? Okay, you can actually apply again. So we have actually just opened up another recruitment cycle just starting this Monday. So the role is actually live now on our career page. You can actually apply again. And then you will be invited to take an online assessment, which is our carrot assessment. Yeah. So just let me share a little bit more about the recruit application process again. So all candidates will be invited to complete an online assessment first before you can actually participate on the on-site interviews. Yeah, so if you pass the online assessment, we will invite you to the on-site interviews. The interview process will be the same. I think the process will be the same. Maybe, to this student, would you be able to further clarify your question? How would it be different if I got? The process is still the same, yeah. So it's the same. We have a very consistent approach for all interviews. Glad I answered your question. Yeah. Yeah. So for students who like to learn more about the differences between a data scientist role and a product scientist, I've just dropped my email in the Zoom chat. So if you'd like to learn more, I do have some materials that I can share with you. Yeah, just feel free, just drop me an email. Okay, is there any other question? We still have 5 minutes left. If not, we will let Yichao and Ingsu take their rest. Okay, Chai, I think yeah, we can conclude the session already.
Yep. Thanks so much, Kelvin, Yichao, and Ingsu for joining us and answering our participants' questions. Thanks so much, Yichao, for conducting the workshop. I think our participants got to learn a lot. Yeah, thanks everyone for staying till the end. It would be great if you could fill the feedback form by scanning the QR code or going to the link. I think we take our feedback seriously, so it will really help us in improving the next iteration of the workshop. Yeah, so I will just leave this link on for a while. And then if you've filled the feedback form and you don't have any more questions to ask, feel free to leave. But I'll be stopping the recording now. So if you have any questions you want to ask off the record, feel free. Yeah. I'm going to stop the recording now. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you.